Okay, welcome. So welcome to Policy Integrity's fifth anniversary conference. This is an annual conference that we have that brings together academics, government officials, and NGO leaders to the law school to focus on issues that are of interest to us and hopefully of importance to other people as well. I have an apology. My wonderful successor as Dean of the Law School, Trevor Morrison, I stepped down as Dean of the Law School on May 31st. I was succeeded by Trevor Morrison, who was looking forward to coming and welcoming us. He has a family health issue to attend to, so he couldn't be here. It's nothing serious, it's just that needed to get taken care of right now. And so, so we'll start without his blessing. And from my perspective, it's actually great to know the law school is in his spectacular hands, and I can now focus more intensely on my scholarship, on environmental regulation, and on the work of the Institute for Policy Integrity, which I direct. So the Institute grew out of a book that Mike Livermore and I published in 2008. So Mike is a 2006 alumnus of NYU Law School, and he was one of my students when we started collaborating on this project. The title was provocative. It was Retaking Rationality: How Cost-Benefit Analysis Can Better Protect the Environment and Our Health. Among other things, we decried the lack of involvement of environmental organizations in methodological debates about how cost-benefit analysis should be conducted. We showed how they had ceded the ground to trade associations representing regulated entities and to anti-regulatory academics. The result was an entrenchment of a set of fallacies that gave cost-benefit analysis an anti-regulatory effect that was not supported either by economic theory or by empirical analysis. So in the perceptive words of one of the best presidents the US has ever had, Josiah Bartlett of the West Wing, President Bartlett said, "Decisions are made by those who show up." And I really liked that, and it was sort of the title of one of the chapters in our book, and that was, we perceived, part of the problem. An important group wasn't there, and decisions were being made, it was just being made without them. So Mike and I founded Policy Integrity in the summer of 2008 to attempt to right that wrong. I had always thought this was something that I wanted to do once I stepped down as dean, but the time seemed so compelling then that we started at that time instead, so sort of 5 years early. Mike was a terrific executive director for 5 years, and as of July 1, he's a law professor at the University of Virginia, but he continues working closely with us as our senior advisor. He's aged too, so senior seemed appropriate. So Policy Integrity is a cross between a think tank and an advocacy organization, and it has two principal objectives. So first, to promote the use of cost-benefit analysis as an unbiased tool for policy evaluation, rather than one that is implemented in a way that puts a thumb on the scale in favor of anti-regulatory interests. And second, to promote the use of flexible tools for meeting environmental standards, including cap and trade and other marketable permit mechanisms, so as to achieve these standards at the lowest possible cost to society. Our core work is in the environmental area, but we've also tackled other areas of social policy, including education, criminal justice, and communications, where he has taken strong positions in favor of evidence-based decision-making and of the consideration of the full range of consequences of government action. And we may continue to work outside of the environmental area in the future, depending on the interests of our funders and of our staff. In addition, we tackle overarching administrative process questions that affect multiple areas of government action, such as the treatment of petitions for rulemaking, and the proper remedies when regulations are set aside in the course of judicial review. We're very honored, given the fact that this is a serious interest of ours, that the czar of this area, the chair of the Administrative Conference of the United States, Paul Verkeil, is here with us. It means a lot to us, Paul. So So we work to implement our objectives in four ways. First, by producing academic scholarship. Mike and I continue writing things after we publish our book. We're still doing that. We're trying to actually finish an article today as this is all going on. And other people at Policy Integrity do that too. Second, by participating directly in the regulatory process before both agencies and courts. Third, by working to increase the capacity of environmental and other public interest organizations to be effective participants on the issues that we focus on. And fourth, by training our postgraduate fellows and the students in a regulatory policy clinic that we run to go on to play leadership roles on these issues, as many of them have done. Mike Livermore, who will talk next, will give you a brief sense of what we've been doing recently on each of these fronts. But before I turn over the podium to him, let me say how pleased I am that you are here for what I'm confident will be a great day of discussion of some of the key regulatory questions that our nation faces. We'll hear in this conference from Howard Chalansky, the Administrator of the Office of Information Regulatory Affairs in the White House Office of Management and Budget, which is a key actor, perhaps the key actor, on many of the issues that Policy Integrity works on. After lunch, I'll also moderate a panel on OIRA's role with individuals who've played a significant role in that area over the last several decades. In addition, this morning we'll hear a discussion concerning the development of a hugely important number, the social cost of carbon, which is the damage caused by one metric ton of carbon dioxide emissions. This number is likely to play a key role in the evaluation of environmental and energy policy in the coming decades. In an interesting turn of events, the administration's efforts to quantify this adverse impact is being opposed by the regulated community, the traditional supporters of cost-benefit analysis, and supported by a consortium of significant environmental actors. Unlike the situation that Mike and I described in our book, these environmental organizations are now very engaged in discussion of methodological approaches to the valuation of these important environmental benefits. I believe that Policy Integrity has been an important catalyst and is playing a significant role in this effort. This afternoon, we will also discuss one powerful rhetorical argument used for and against environmental regulation. Claims about how many jobs will be created or killed due to new protections. Advocates on both sides have made vastly exaggerated claims. On the one side, the green jobs side, they would have us believe that if enough regulation could be put in place, we would solve our nation's unemployment. And the claim on the other side is that our regulatory trajectory is likely to lead to massive unemployment. My favorite number is one regulation that was predicted by this other side to kill 1.5 million jobs. And it looked to me to be kind of pretty run-of-the-mill, you know, important run-of-the-mill regulation. I thought, well, there must be 100 regulations like this in the country, which would mean that by now we would all be unemployed. which thankfully hasn't yet happened. So our final panel will look at how to move away from extreme, analytically dubious claims to a best practices approach on the question of the impact of regulation on jobs, which is actually a serious and important question. So I now leave you in the great hands of my wonderful colleague and friend, Mike Livermore, Policy Integrity's founding executive director and senior advisor.
Great. Thanks very much. Thanks very much, Ricky. And it's, of course, it's a real pleasure to be back in New York and back amongst the team at Policy Integrity, where I spent the last 5 years. And I especially would like to thank Edna Shayek and Valerie Stahl have helped kind of pull together this conference, this workshop, and really played a large role to make this all happen. So I'm just going to spend a couple of minutes discussing some of the work that Policy Integrity is engaged in now, looking forward to the next 5 years under Ricky's leadership. So one of the projects that I think is kind of most exemplary of the way that Policy Integrity does business is a project on the social cost of carbon. So Ricky mentioned that this number is being used to evaluate the benefits associated with regulations that reduce greenhouse gas emissions. And we'll be talking about this number in the next panel. But The project that Policy Integrity has been engaged on is in collaboration with NRDC and EDF, two of the major environmental organizations, and is funding, who are funding a position within Policy Integrity, Peter Howard, who is who's a postdoc economics fellow. And this project, the goal of the project is to kind of bridge an ongoing gap in the discourse between the scientific community, the economics community, and the public policy community. That these are three different conversations that are happening kind of simultaneously about the social cost of carbon, about the long-term effects associated with greenhouse gas emissions and the best way to reduce those emissions, but that are happening on parallel tracks and rarely intersecting. And the goal with the project is to bring those conversations together so that we can have more meaningful, ultimately more meaningful and well-informed policy solutions. So that's one area that I think well exemplifies where Policy Integrity is and where it's going going in the future. Two other interesting projects that the organization is engaged in that are also, I think, noteworthy involve litigation. And if we're at a law school, so it would really be a shame if we never litigated. I feel like that is, we would not be using our comparative advantage. And so there are two pieces of litigation that are noteworthy, again, and show kind of the Policy's Integrity's comparative advantage. One is a lawsuit that's currently being litigated in the DC Circuit having to do with the economic analysis that underpins how we prioritize leasing of oil exploration rights for the Outer Continental Shelf. And it turns out that although the agency does quite sophisticated cost-benefit analysis of that question, there is a well-known economic principle that doesn't play a role in that analysis, which is the value of the option to delay leasing these offshore rights. These options are very valuable, and they're ignored and have consistently been ignored over the last 30 years in the agency's analysis of this issue. And after the notice and comment process, where the agency was urged to adopt an options approach, the agency didn't do that, and there's currently litigation in the DC Circuit that Policy Integrity is engaged with to move the ball forward on that issue. And then another litigation project that Policy Integrity is engaged in was recently Policy Integrity submitted a brief to the Supreme Court on a recent rulemaking by the Obama administration that was overturned in the DC Circuit having to do with the interstate transport of air pollution. So the agency had interpreted a language within the Clean Air Act in such a way as to allow a more efficient allocation of the costs and burdens associated with cleaning up interstate air pollution. And it was, I think, to many commentators, quite an intelligent and well-designed approach that the agency had arrived at. Unfortunately, it was, as I said, it was struck down in the DC Circuit, and Policy Integrity submitted an amicus brief to the Supreme Court in support of the agency's interpretation in ongoing litigation there. And that project, I think, is useful because, again, the goal that the organization has is to promote interpretations of the law that allow for efficient, intelligent, designed regulatory solutions, especially given the fact that we're now interpreting like a 30-year-old law, and the agency ought to have some discretion to achieve our social goals and pollution reduction goals at low cost. A final brief note before we start the next panel is on a couple of collaborative and interdisciplinary projects that Policy Integrity is engaged in. One is recently funded by the Sloan Foundation, is going to take a look at the National Flood Insurance Program. It's a very large program. It's not necessarily one that's financially on all fours. This runs a very large debt and may have negative consequences both for development in environmentally sensitive areas and for basically de-incentivizing climate adaptation, both things that you would want to avoid with the government program. So this is a large project. It's in collaboration with Resources for the Future and some other kind of high-profile collaborators. We've after a like 4-year process, we got data from FEMA on the flood insurance program. We'll be using that, leveraging that data as well as some survey information to see how individuals respond to the incentives provided by the flood insurance program and whether it in fact does have these negative consequences of, say, encouraging building in floodplains that is inefficient. So there's another set of ongoing collaborations that I'll just briefly highlight is with the medical school here at NYU, and there's a very strong environmental health department there, air quality department, and policy integrity, again, at the intersection of law, economics, and public health, has a project that's recently bearing fruit, studying how the increase in availability of natural gas has reduced air, has improved air quality in New York, has reduced emissions from alternative sources, and looking at both the public health and the quantifiable economic benefits associated with that. So those are just a few projects that Policy Integrity is engaged in. It continues to do fantastic work under Ricky's leadership, along with the leadership of Jason Schwartz and others who have stayed at Policy Integrity and continue to do great work. So it's a real pleasure to be here.
Well, thank you. So I will actually get off the stage. Mike is moderating the next panel. So if the panelists for the social cost of carbon panel can come up, we'll move straight on to that panel. Thanks so much for being here.
So I'll sit here and then I'll move for folks that are going to use the PowerPoint.
Yes, David. Michael.
Sure. Yes, thank you. We're already 5 minutes behind. Great. Okay. Well, we'll just go ahead and get started. Again, thanks everyone for being here. This panel is going to be on the social cost of carbon. I will largely leave the discussion to our distinguished guests. We've really collected an outstanding group of experts on this issue. We couldn't be happier. I will provide just 2 minutes worth of framing. So, as we've mentioned, the social cost of carbon is the number that is currently being used by the administration to value the benefits that are associated with greenhouse gas reductions. You might think that this number would be uncontroversial. Well, it turns out it's not uncontroversial at all. It's, in fact, quite controversial. Not only the specific number that's being used in the inputs, which will really be the subject of this discussion today, but even whether we ought to be using a number at all to value the benefits that are associated with these regulations. And so what was for many years a kind of wonky, in-the-weeds discussion among economists and some kind of particularly savvy administrative law types has kind of blown up and become a high-profile political issue, the subject of hearings on the Hill, the subject of news reports in places like the Wall Street Journal, and so this has now become a high-profile political issue, even though it is actually, maybe even in part, because it's such a sophisticated and difficult to understand question. So we have a wonderful panel. I will actually turn it over to them now after short introductions. You can learn more about them online. It's a wonderful group. Michael Greenstone is here. He's the 3M Professor of Environmental Economics in the Department of Economics at MIT. He's a non-resident senior fellow at the Brookings Institution. He's a research associate at the National Bureau of Economic Research, and he was most recently the director of the Hamilton Project at the Brookings Institution from 2010 to 2013. And he also served as the chief economist for President Obama's Council of Economic Advisors at the early part of the administration and during a time when the work on the social cost of carbon that we'll be discussing today was taking place in a very profound way. We'll also hear from Bob Kopp. He is an assistant professor at the Department of Earth and Planetary Sciences, at Rutgers University, and he's the associate director of Rutgers Energy Institute at Rutgers University. And so, Bob is a climate economist who's also quite sophisticated understanding of economics, and so this kind of the intersection of those.
I was saying, I'm not an economist.
You're not an economist. No, I'm at a climate scientist. So he's this climate scientist who has a sophisticated understanding of economics, and sometimes he speaks more economics than the economists do, which is a little disconcerting, actually. David Anthoff is an assistant professor in the School of Natural Resources and the Environment at the University of Michigan. He has his PhD in economics from the University of Hamburg and the International Max Planck's Research School on Earth Systems Modeling. And so he'll be joining us, and he'll be discussing some of the issues around global valuations. And then we have Rich Howard, who's a professor of environmental studies at Dartmouth College and the editor-in-chief of Ecological Economics. So we have a really wonderful panel today. I'm just thrilled that you are here, and I look forward to hearing your remarks. So we'll start with Michael Greenstone.
Thanks very much for the chance to come and talk about the social cost of carbon. It's not usually a topic that is good for polite company, but we're going to try and fix that today. Okay, so I'm going to talk a little bit about what the social cost of carbon is, how it got started. There's several people in the room here who have contributed to it, but I think this started. Economists, my wife often jokes that we are the master of the obvious. And so this process started, if you can all think back to maybe February or March 2009, when the economy was losing 700,000 jobs a month. And at the same time, there was hope of passing a carbon bill that would, in one way or another, increase the cost of energy. And a couple of us had the idea that, gosh, maybe this wasn't going to be the time that people would be excited about raising the price of energy. Shouldn't there be a backup strategy for doing climate policy? And at the time, the federal government had a somewhat schizophrenic approach to regulating carbon. I think the Department of Transportation, in its kind of cost-benefit analyses, often place the cost of an extra ton of carbon in the atmosphere that leads to climate change at something around zero. And other agencies, I think, thought of it as unquantifiable on the positive side. And since a ton of carbon, whether or not it's reduced in one sector or another, has the same effect, it seemed like at least getting the same number across the federal government and also grounding that number in science and economics would be a good exercise. So that's what we tried to do. Let me now talk about some of the details. So this is, you know, I think in this audience it's probably almost unnecessary, but I cannot resist putting it up. The gray bars or yellow bars, depending on your vision, are the number of days that the average American faces currently where the temperature falls in one of those temperature ranges. So the top one is greater than 90 degrees Fahrenheit, and the bottom one is less than 10. And then the others are 10 degree Fahrenheit wide ranges. And so just to note, the key thing is that the typical day for the average American, given where people live, falls somewhere in the 60 to 70 range. And people have about 70 to 75 days like that a year. The red bars are are the reason we're probably here talking about the social cost of carbon. And they are the predicted change in the number of days in each of those categories. And what you should see is that right now we really don't have any days where the temperature is great on it, you know, one day a year where the temperature is greater than 90. That's the average of the high and the low. And we're projected to have at the end of the century about 30 extra days like that per year. And for 80 to 90, even more, say 50. And the reason that that's disconcerting is that all the damages, most of the damage associated with high temperatures are really at the high end. So we're going to move from a bunch of days that don't do a lot of harm to a bunch of days that do a lot of harm. So that's our refresher on climate change. Let me talk a little bit about the legislative landscape. The House did pass the Waxman-Markey cap and trade bill in June 2009. It never was voted on in the Senate. And I think, you know, this is outside my area of expertise, but I don't think that, to me, it doesn't look like there's a huge tidal wave of movement for voting for a price on carbon in the Congress currently. And so I think what we're probably going to be using is the Clean Air Act. And the Clean Air Act in the Supreme Court gave the EPA their right and responsibility to regulate greenhouse gases under the Clean Air Act. I think there's lots of predictions out there, but probably the most kind of standard view is that if you add up the rules on mobile sources, so that's the CAFE regulations, the rules on new stationary sources and the existing stationary sources, that could potentially all lead to a reduction in carbon emissions kind of on the order of 5 to 12% by 2020 relative to 2005. And that's in the range of what the president promised, a little bit lower, but what the president promised in Copenhagen. The question that the social cost of carbon is supposed to help provide guidance on is, will these regulations have net benefits? So how can we design these regulations so that on net they're beneficial? And to do that, you have to have a monetized value of a reduction for each ton in carbon emissions. And so that is called the social cost of carbon. Precisely, it's the monetized damages associated with an incremental increase in carbon emissions in a given year. It's meant to capture all of the damages, and those include changes in agricultural productivity, changes in human health, property damages from increased flood risk. We're around the anniversary of Sandy right now, the value of ecosystem services, and on and on and on. And it's meant to capture all of that. And let me show you how it can really be useful. So here's an example of a rule that was meant to reduce greenhouse gas emissions for light-duty trucks. So in the top row, you can see that the social benefits of that, excluding carbon, and we'll come to that in a minute, were about $277 billion, and that's between 2010 and 2050. There's a lot of assumptions underneath that, but let's just take this as an example. The costs of that rule are about $345 billion. And so the net benefits of that rule are minus roughly $70 billion. So what does that say? That says if we were to implement this rule, society would be worse off, and be worse off to the tune of roughly $70 billion. But of course, the purpose, one of the main primary purposes of that rule is to reduce carbon. And so there has to be, and that's measured in tons of carbon dioxide emissions, and there has to be a way to convert that into dollars so that we have apples to apples comparisons. And when you do that, you can see that there's this very large reduction in carbon, and that has a large economic value. And it takes this rule, which is a rule that would not look very good to pursue, and makes it a rule that is socially beneficial. In this case, it increases, the total net benefits are now about $110 billion. All right, so how does this mysterious social cost of carbon emerge? So first, it was done, I think, I've only spent a year and a half in government, but it was an interagency process, which I didn't know what that was before I went to government. But it basically included, it was convened by the Council of Economic Advisors, where I was, and the Office of Management Budget, which was the OIRA division, was led by Cass Sunstein, and then had deep involvement from the Council on Environmental Quality, the National Economic Council, the Office of Energy and Climate Change, the Office of Science and Technology Policy, the EPA, Agriculture, Commerce, Energy, Transportation, Treasury. It was kind of a remarkable collection of people with really impressive skills. Bob was one of them. Al McGartland is also here, also played an important role. And people brought expertise on science, on economics, on law, and tried to come up with this collective judgment of what the social cost of carbon was. So let's go a little bit into what were the choices that group faced. So the first decision was to use something called an integrated assessment model. Integrated assessment models combine climate processes, economic growth, and feedbacks between the climate and global economy into a single model. And you could think of it as having four steps. They start with some assumption about emissions, how much are we going to emit, feed that into the atmosphere, Then the climate scientists tell us the relationship between greenhouse gas concentrations and temperature. And then that comes back around to the relationship between temperature and economic damages or our well-being. They're very complex models. I think the best quote I've ever heard about them is they're a lot like democracy in the sense that there's a lot of things that are wrong with it, but they're the best system we have. The group relied on three commonly used IAMs, the FUN model, the DICE model, and the PAGE model. Those were chosen because they're the three most frequently cited integrated assessment models that are out there. In using those models, several assumptions had to be made. The first was the damage functions, and I think we're going to hear more about that as we go along. And the second was there had to be an assumption about the growth in global GDP, global population, and global CO2. The third is an equilibrium climate sensitivity parameter. So what does that mean? It means if we doubled CO2, what would happen to temperature? And there's a vigorous scientific debate about that, where I think the group really got itself to the frontier. Then there's a question about global damages versus domestic damages, and finally, discount rates. And I should say, as you know, someone who knew a chunk about part of this, but certainly not all the pieces, it was really an impressive group. And I think one thing that people tried to do was to do no new science, but rather to skim off the frontier of science and policy and economics. And I think there was a view that it would have been inappropriate for bunch of federal bureaucrats to try and do science on their own, and rather that the goal, and in my view, the right goal, was to summarize what was the state of the art. So what is done is all the models are run together, and they produced 45 separate distributions of the social cost of government. I'm not going to show you each of them, but the reason there's 45 is we had the three models, five sets of socioeconomic assumptions, one climate sensitivity distribution, and the three discount rates. And so that produced three separate probability distributions for the social cost of carbon in each year, each associated with a different discount rate. Okay, and so here is the moment that we've all been waiting for, breathlessly. What I'm going to show is a distribution of values of the social cost of carbon in 2010, assuming a 3% discount rate, from 150,000 model runs. Each of the 15 socioeconomic scenario pairs is run a total of 10,000 times to adequately sample the distribution. Okay, and so here's the full distribution, and you can see that there are a couple values way out at greater than 200. There's a couple that are actually negative, which would suggest more carbon is good for the world, but the mass, or the most of the weight, is all around kind of in the around the $10 to $20 to $30 range, there are some different ways to summarize that. One way to do is just to check out what the values are at different percentiles in that distribution, and so I just chose some here. At the fifth percentile, it's -$9. As I said, this is the seemingly perverse result. But there's almost no probability that is likely. And at the 50th percentile, it's $14. And then at the 90th percentile, it goes all the way up to $65. I should emphasize, these numbers are from the 2010 social cost of carbon that was recently updated. None of the assumptions we just talked about were changed. The only thing that changed was that the models themselves have advanced as the science has advanced, and there's a greater understanding of the damages associated with climate change. And I'll show you how those in this next slide, what that has done to the numbers. So one thing that's highly controversial in this process is to try and figure out what's the discount rate. And the discount rate is the number that tells you how to value a dollar of damages at some point in the future. And the collective judgment was to do these estimates at four different values. The first is at 3%, with a 3% discount rate, and calculating the mean of that distribution. The second is 2.5%. The third is 5%. And then in light of the possibility of really severe climate change that the models in one way or another were not adequately picking up, there was also a calculation done using the 3% discount rate and the 95th percentile. So that's all the way out in the distribution. And so if you just read down there, down the row, you can see that this produces, and the reason that the 3% mean is highlighted is that that's the number that was supposed to be emphasized in policymaking and determinative of which regulations would be net beneficial. And that implied a social cost of carbon of $21. So this is slightly mislabeled. It's labeled correctly. In 2010, if you use the updated models, that number is roughly 50% higher. It's at $33. I think Bob can probably talk about this much more intelligently than I can, but I think that's largely due to a greater awareness of the damages associated with floods. But these are effectively the numbers that are going to determine. So I think in June there will be existing power plant rules, and these are the numbers that will help determine where to set that standard and where the benefits, which are the reductions in the intensity of climate change, will fall relative to the costs, which will primarily be in the form of higher electricity prices. And this is just to highlight that these numbers grow over time. Okay, so we have an excellent panel, and I don't want to take too much time, but the conclusions just are that the social cost of carbon offers a way to measure the economic value of emissions reductions. The use of the social cost of carbon is currently guiding and will continue to guide greenhouse gas regulations, be they energy efficiency regulations or, as I was just talking about, the regulations on power plants. And they provide a guidepost to achieve regulations where the benefits so that exceed the cost, so that society is pursuing regulations that are on net beneficial. Okay.
So we'll hear next from Bob Kopp. You had PowerPoint.
Right.
Yes.
Okay. We'll save the questions for the end.
Yeah, we'll save questions for the end.
All right. So Michael gave a great overview of sort of the 2010 regulatory assessment or interagency process to come up with the social cost of carbon numbers that have been used for the last 2.5 years in regulatory assessments, which were just recently updated on the basis of revised versions of models, including one that our co-panelist David Anthoff works on. I want to provide a little bit, sort of step away a little bit from the particular regulatory context and look forward to sort of where the research in this area is going. As Michael said, I'm a climate scientist. I'm not an economist, and I got involved in this process because for the sort of year that the interagency process was going on, I was at the Climate Change Policy Office at the Department of Energy, and so got to talk to economists a lot and work. So one of the things I do now is try to help natural scientists and economists talk to one another. So I want to sort of present to you a little bit of that perspective from the sciences. And I apologize, my slides are really more designed for sort of a big projector, so hopefully they'll be visible. And I think I do have. In terms of laser pointer. This slide is sort of illustrating something Michael already talked about, which is how these models that are used to calculate the social cost of carbon actually work. I wonder if I here. These are models that sort of combine the scientific and economic perspectives. So for all of these, you have to start with some sort of projection of what the economy is going to do into the future, and actually quite a bit into the future, because a lot of the damages coming from climate change, we start to see most severely sort of later in the century, and then really, as I'll talk about in a bit, in coming centuries. So you start out with some baseline projection or set of baseline projections of economic growth. And then from those projections, economists can tell you what, given a set of assumptions about technology, what sort of carbon dioxide and greenhouse gas emissions are likely to be associated with those projections. So that's what this figure here is showing you. This is a set of projections for a bunch of different scenarios and assumptions about technology. This is not the particular scenarios that were used in the interagency process. These are just illustrative scenarios. And then if economists come and say, give me or give another climate scientist a set of economic projections that tell you emissions, we can go and look at how those emissions go into the atmosphere, ultimately go and cycle into the oceans, and how that the resulting atmosphere concentrations of carbon dioxide changes over time. So, for example, many of you may have noticed that earlier this year we passed 400 parts per million carbon dioxide in the atmosphere, at least briefly. By the end of the century, we might be looking at 700, 800, 1,000 parts per million of CO2, depending on what emissions projections you use. From those, again, the climate scientists can go and turn a sort of set of projections about emissions into temperature projections, as well as if you're looking at a sort of more detailed things like changes in precipitation, changes in sea level. And then you come to the part which is most complicated because it requires natural scientists and economists to actually work together, which is how you turn those physical projections of things like temperature and precipitation change into impacts on society, impacts on ecosystems, and then how you value those. And so that linkage here is where the damage functions in the integrated assessment models come in, and that's what I'm going to focus on. As Michael mentioned, the interagency process used three different models, DICE, FUND, and PAGE. There are a couple more that are out there, some of which weren't around when we did the first interagency assessment. This figure is from a paper, or modified from a paper that Brian McNown and I worked on a year or two ago, and it's looking at three integrated assessment models that provide either distinct calibrations or distinct projections for different sorts of impacts. So I don't know if people can actually read this, but each of these sets of bars are reflecting different sorts of impacts, and the different colors of bars are representing projections from three different models. So what sort of sectors, what sort of impacts are we thinking about? Well, there's things like agricultural impacts. So if you change temperature, you change crop yield, something I will talk about in a bit, and as you also change precipitation patterns, which could have impacts on agriculture. Those are not captured in the sort of models that use estimated social cost of carbon. You can have changes in water availability, which will have economic impacts. You will have changes in energy demand as well as energy production. The energy production estimates are not well captured in these sorts of integrated assessment models. But energy demand, things like less demand for heating and more demand for air conditioning. In FUND, which is the model that David Anthoff works on, that's actually one of the major sources of economic costs associated with climate change. Another sort of damage I'll talk about more because it's actually where a lot of my scientific research focuses, and on sort of sea level impacts, something we all have a lot of experience of in because of Sandy. One major sort of impact that's sort of emerging and was not really in a great degree in the models that were used for the interagency process, but new work suggests might be important, is there's health impact, but then particularly direct impacts on labor productivity. It turns out that under higher temperatures, people are less productive, mostly in the sectors that work outside, but this is actually quite a large effect. One of these more recent models, something called Envisage, suggest that might actually be the dominant economic impact of climate change. And then there are other things which are very hard to value and I think are easily contestable, but just how do you value things like loss of unique ecosystems, loss of unique communities. And then on top of that, there's all the stuff we don't know, right? What's labeled on this plot as sort of expected catastrophic damages, which one of the models used in the interagency process, DICE, and another one, PAGE, try to represent in some very abstract form. FUND, because this is such an abstract thing, doesn't include at all. And then I'll give you some more examples of that. And what do we know? Well, from these sectors that are included in these assessments, the total expected damages, so sort of taking an expected value for the catastrophic impacts, at 2.5 degrees C of warming above pre-industrial temperatures, so that's about 4.5 degrees Fahrenheit, something in the range of 0 to 2% GDP loss from these models, 0 to 4% if you look at another set of models. But the other thing is that this is, you know, this is the sort of temperature range these models are calibrated against. I think all of the researchers working on this realize, you know, in terms of damages, things get much harder to project once we go about above about 4 degrees Fahrenheit of warming, which we're very likely to be doing in this century. So what makes a good damage estimates? Well, I turn to our former vice president for that. Getting damages right, we really need to do good sort of what best estimates, what's most likely to happen, but also good 1% estimates, since in slightly modified words from Dick Cheney, if there's a 1% chance of extreme climate change impacts, we have to treat it as a certainty in terms of a response. Making the point that risk aversion, you know, is an important part of how we think about climate change policy. And, you know, we can't really assess the risks of climate change if we aren't thinking about that tail of impacts. Now, of course, he wasn't actually talking about climate change impacts. He was talking about Pakistani assistance for an Al-Qaeda nuclear weapon. But the point about risk aversion holds in this case as well. So let's just look at a few of the areas where there's some important research going on that is slowly starting to work its way into integrated assessment models and perhaps might influence the next round of the social cost of carbon assessment, or maybe the one after that. And I think one of the key points is that a lot of the damages we think about from climate change aren't necessarily damages just from the average change in the climate. They're damages resulting from how those averages interact with changes in natural variability. Right? So those of us who are in this area, I think Sandy sort of brought that home to us. Right? This is, I keep wanting to point with this, but this is a picture of Manitowocan in New Jersey before Sandy. This is a picture of the same community a couple days after Sandy. And you could see just, you know, it wasn't the 8 inches of sea level rise that happened over the course of the 20th century because of climate change that caused this damage. But certainly the interaction of those 8 inches with the storm factor made a difference for a number of people. In New York and New Jersey, there were about 75,000 people who were exposed to flooding because of Sandy who wouldn't have been exposed without the sea level rise that occurred as a result of climate change during the 20th century. So point one is that when we think about damages, we have to think about the interactions between variability, which is what we call weather, and changes in the mean, which is what we call climate. Just one more illustration of this. This is some work, I'm afraid this is an old version of the slide, but what we're looking at here on this bar on the left, this is a range of flood levels associated with different storms over the last 60 or 70 years. These are projections for the battery. These are observations for the battery, rather. And so you can see sort of the 10-year storm, that's a storm, the flooding and incidence that has about a 10% chance of occurring in any given year. That's about 8.5 feet of flooding above mean lowest low water. If you look at sea level rise projections for this century, which is something that I've been working on in New Jersey, if you take sort of a moderately high scenario, one that might, you know, sort of expert judgment have a probability of 10% chance of occurring. By 2100, we might see about 5.5 feet of sea level rise in this area because there are certain factors that cause sea level rise to be more severe in the Northeast than globally. Well, if you take 5.5 feet of sea level rise, one thing that happens is that this 10-year flood interval, just add 5.5 feet to it, that gets you up to the flooding level of Superstorm Sandy. Right? So that interaction matters. And another thing we have to think about when we think about damages is how people are going to respond to damages. Do we want to just think about damages in terms of how people who are sort of completely without foresight are impacted by them? Or do we want to take into account the fact that people will be adapting to these in some fashion? Some of the models sort of assume perfect market-driven adaptation. I think it's pretty clear that people are not going to completely ignore the fact that climate change is happening, but they're also not going to adapt perfectly. There's a lot of imperfections built into social systems. One local example, this question, again, on sort of sea level rise in New Jersey and the coast, is what to do about dune constructions. And after Sandy, there were a couple of cases where residents who had been very strongly opposed to dune construction suddenly found themselves with homes that existed because of dune construction that they had fought against. And you know, sort of run recent follow-up in July, the Supreme Court of New Jersey overturned a ruling that had been upheld by all lower courts by a couple who lived in Harvey Cedars, who had sort of sued the town for $375,000 on improper eminent domain charges. And then the Supreme Court decided, well, you know, their house still existed. That benefit to them should be taken into account, and maybe the town didn't owe them $375,000. But it pointed out, you know, we have to think about adaptation and how social systems are responding. Another sort of thing that research area that's been emerging over the last several years are sort of empirical studies, some of which Michael has been involved in, of how economic and social systems have responded in the past to natural climate change variability, which can help calibrate projections of how they're going to respond into the future. This particular figure is from some work by Wolfram Schlenker, and that's showing you the response of corn yields to exposures to different temperatures for a day. And you'll notice that there's sort of a very slight increase of corn yields up until about 25 degrees Celsius, and then a relatively rapid drop off with exposure to temperatures higher than that. And so this can be, but hasn't yet been incorporated into integrated assessment models. This figure is just showing you projections of sort of changes in damages to US agriculture from three different integrated assessment models, which are these high curves. This is a 0% line. So you can see for up until about 1.5 degrees warming, some of the models are predicting net benefits to US agriculture. If you use the empirical observations to calibrate what sort of damages happen, you see much more negative effects by the time you get to just 2 degrees of warming, sort of mid-century levels. So as I said, so impacts estimated by the integrated assessment models can and should be tested against historical observations. And this complicated figure is just saying, again, this is a case where variability, the interaction between weather and climate matters. You know, we have natural variability around the climate means there's some bad years for agriculture, there's some good years. If you put, say, 10 degrees Fahrenheit of warming, sort of a high-end projection for the end of the century, on top of sort of natural variability, what you find is that what would have been sort of a 1 in 20 year crop loss events becomes an annual occurrence. And you start seeing sort of in bad years, or even every few years, sort of crop loss of a level that has no precedent in the particular time period we looked at, which was 1973 to 1998. So, two more points. One, I highlighted that sort of expected catastrophic damages terms and some of the damage functions. One of the things we know from studying natural systems is that there's a lot we don't understand about them. I was at a meeting in Rome last week on sort of past and future sea level changes, and one of the things I learned there is that some of the people working on modeling the behavior of the Antarctic ice sheet thinks there's sort of first order physics that people hadn't realized were first order about things, how ice cliffs respond when you start eroding the edges of these ice sheets that are based on marine edges. People hadn't realized that was sort of a first order effect controlling ice sheets. And so you know, perhaps we might have been more conservative in our projections of how the Antarctic ice sheet might respond to sea level change than we would be otherwise. But there are things like how the ice sheets will respond, things like how the deep water formation in the North Atlantic, which controls a lot of the climate and sea level in the North Atlantic, will respond. Things like whether the Amazon rainforest might die off, how the monsoon in India might be disruptive. All of these things are potential large-scale effects in the Earth system that we don't have good estimates of the probability for. Probably none of them individually are that high in the 21st century, but that doesn't mean none of them are going to occur. And we don't have a good sense of what their human consequences will be. So that's an expected catastrophic term, and that's something that sort of that interface between the natural changes and the human changes is something we need to work on. And my final point is that climate change doesn't stop in 2100, which is, most of a physical climate modelers still run our projections out to 2100, but that's getting closer and closer every time people do that. So instead of being 100-year projections, they're now 85-year projections. But we do know that some of the effects of sort of business as usual may be quite extreme, particularly in the 22nd century. This is a figure showing something called maximum wet bulb temperature. This is basically a measure of the combined effect of heat and humidity. And it's an interesting thing because once wet bulb temperature gets above about 35 degrees Celsius, I can't really do that conversion in my head, but it's going to be something like 100 degrees Fahrenheit. Your human body can't cool itself effectively. The wet bulb temperature is measuring your ability to respond to sort of the combination of heat and humidity. And if it's so humid that you can't cool yourself by sweating, you can't actually survive in those conditions. And what this figure is showing you is for 11 degrees C warming, but pre-industrial, so that's 20 degrees Fahrenheit of warming, but that's something that starts to become plausible around there's 2200, what that means for the maximum wet bulb temperature. So all of the areas and these shades, these sort of strong light purple shades, say the eastern US and India and eastern China, these are areas that with 11 degrees of warming could become uninhabitable for parts of the year. It's a large effect. It's not something we have to deal with in the century, but we might want, if we're on a course that causes the eastern US basically not to be inhabitable in the summer, that is, if you're outside and exposed to temperatures, you die, which is a set of conditions that doesn't exist on the Earth anywhere today, it might still be something we want to think about in terms of how we respond. So just to sum up, I think the damage estimates are an important part of this process. They can't be made by economists in isolation. I think it's something where natural science, social science, and economics all need to talk to one another.
We'll hear from David Anton.
All right. Hi. Welcome. Thanks for having me. I should probably, in terms of full disclosure, say what my relation to all of this is. I co-developed one of the three models that was used in the interagency group, the FUNT model. I ran the model back in when the first round of SEC estimates was computed, and that had actually a quite profound effect on me personally. So there were 2 weeks when all of a sudden we got the go, now we have everything sorted out about the specifications and how you have to run that. I had the flu during those 2 weeks. So I shuffled back and forth between my bed and the computer to come up with these estimates. And after these 2 weeks, I had this beard. So then I decided that was actually handy. So that was the effect on me personally. I was asked to give comments broadly on what I think is important about the social cost of carbon. So these range all over the place. I will focus a little bit on the question of a domestic versus a global social cost of carbon, and then I have just a broad range of issues that I think are important. But I want to start with two dismal points to do our discipline justice. And the first of all is, I just want to remind everyone that the way the social cost of carbon is used right now in regulatory analysis, even if we might be cheerful that an economic estimate of the benefits is used in federal regulation, it's actually not the way economists would want to see carbon emissions regulated, right? This is a typical example of command and control regulation, and decades of research have shown us that is more costly than necessary. So I just, as great it is as it is that we use the social cost of carbon and cost benefit analysis, the good way to regulate this problem is to use either a carbon tax or a cap and trade system, because that will allow us to achieve these goals at lower cost. Just to keep that in mind. That's the first one. The second one is, I just want to put this in what's happening in the US in context. So I think there one can easily get excited that the US is doing something and so on. But keep in mind that this is really a global problem, and whatever the US does domestically with emissions, it's important, but you know, but only so much. So what I've plotted here is from the RICE model, two temperature trajectories. And the blue line is the temperature over the next 200 years, as Bill Nordhaus thinks it will happen if no country does anything in terms of emission reductions. The red-orange line is if the US stops all of its emissions tomorrow. So that's a crazy thing, but just to show you how little influence that has on global temperatures. So it's great that the US is doing something. Every little step helps something, but to solve the climate problem for real, you need to get the rest of the world to do something about this. So if we are talking about regulation in the United States, we're talking about small changes at the margin. We're not talking about a solution to this problem in general. Okay, so these were the decimal points. I will now talk about the question of a domestic versus a global social cost of carbon. So the social cost of carbon is the damage that is caused by an extra emission of CO2 by anyone somewhere on the world. But the damages from an extra emission occur in different jurisdictions, right? So if the US emits a ton of CO2, then that will cause a damage within the US to US citizens, but it will also cause damages to someone in China and Bangladesh and so on. And so the question here is, if you do regulatory analysis, do you take those benefits, if you reduce emissions to someone in Bangladesh, into account or not? And just to set the stage here, what I've plotted here is from two of the, the RICE model is a version of one of the DICE model that was used in the interagency group that is disaggregated by countries, but it's Bill Nordhaus's a model. And what I've done here is I've split the social cost of carbon into the different regions where these benefits occur, right? So if we reduce emissions by one ton, then 7% of the damages that we estimate as the social cost of carbon happen to people within the US, and the rest happens to people somewhere outside of the US. And the fund number is a bit larger for the United States, and I've picked two arbitrary discounting schemes here, but in general, sort of this gives you an idea that if you reduce emissions here, the vast majority of the benefits are happening to people outside of the US borders. So what do you do in that situation? So I think, and this is a really tricky question, but I think the first, the starting point, if you think about that, is whose welfare is the regulator actually caring about in this situation, right? Is the interagency group trying to do a cost-benefit analysis for US citizens or for someone or for the whole world? And my point on that is, quite frankly, that there's very little an economist can tell you what you should do about that question, because that is really maybe a legal, maybe a moral question, maybe a question of politics. There's no right answer to that from an economist, okay? So I think that is a just tricky one. But what I wanted to do now is, if you take either one of these positions, I wanted to talk about some issues that might come up. So let's assume a regulator is only interested in the welfare of US citizens. Apparently, you might think that's simple, right? Just take the 7% of the social cost of carbon and use that as the benefits of your carbon reductions. There are a couple of points that people have brought up in the literature why that might not be so. One is the idea of spillovers. And there might be damages that are caused somewhere outside of the United States borders that might feed back somehow onto the US economy. So you don't care about the poor Bangladeshi, but you might care about an impact, you know, that might have on productivity in Bangladesh and that might harm US citizens. One really has to go into how these models are built to understand that I think that would be incorrect to do something like that, because these damage estimates by and large try to take these spillovers into account already. And this is actually a good idea, a good opportunity to say something about the agricultural damage slide that Bob just showed, where there was a graph that showed that the empirical literature showed large impacts on agricultural yields in the United States from rising temperature, and the integrated assessment model showed sometimes even a benefit. And that seems very much at odds. But it's actually not, because they measure different things. What the integrated assessment models measure are welfare impacts. And the other thing is an impact on yields. Now, a loss in yields to the United States might actually be beneficial for the United States, because there are lots of things going on at the same time. The price of agricultural products goes up. That's great for producers of agricultural products. And there's a large literature that shows, I think that started in the early 90s already, that losses in yields to the United States could be on net beneficial for the United States because of these general equilibrium trade interactions. And that's what these integrated assessment models are calibrated against. So I think that is hopefully taken care of in the calibration of our damage functions, these spillovers. There's another idea that I think Bob in a recent paper brought up, and that's the idea of reciprocity. You might think that if the United States does something, other people, other regions take that as an example and start doing something as well. And that would, of course, be a good reason to use a number that is larger than just the net benefit to US citizens, because these reductions that happen outside of the United States will benefit US citizens, of course. If that would happen, then that would be a very correct argument. Game theory would suggest exactly the opposite. So the rational thing for other countries, if the US does something against climate change, would be to reduce their efforts. If they're maximizing their self-interest. But these things are, you know, it's not in isolation. Climate change might interact with other policy areas. Maybe they're, I think that's really a question for political scientists. I thought I'm at a law school, I should say something about legal liability. I have no clue whether there is any case to be made that there is a legal liability for example, the United States, for the harm that we are doing by our emissions to other countries. But if there were, then that would be a good reason to include the damages that are caused outside of the United States borders in your cost-benefit analysis, because you don't, so analytically that just follows, right? So that might be a third reason. Okay, so that's sort of if you only care about Americans. What if you say we care about the welfare of everyone, we're trying to be good neighbors, we normally don't drive around and dump our garbage into our neighbor's yard, so we're trying to do sort of the same thing with climate change. So let's assume that we care about everyone's welfare. There are two major approaches how we might ask what social cost of carbon we use in that case. The first one is we can be interested in efficiency only. So what does that mean? So there are really two criterion. One is the Kaller-Hicks efficiency criterion. What's the criterion there? It says that if a regulation on net produces so much benefits that all the winners of that regulation could compensate the losers so that at the end no one is worse off from that regulation, then that is an efficient regulation and we should implement it. The key here is that the compensation is a potential compensation test. We just ask, could the winners of that regulation compensate the losers? We never pay that compensation. I think, and that is the, you know, I think all the regulation cost-benefit analysis in the United States is based essentially on that criterion. I think there's a good argument for that within a country, although, you know, you might produce losers, but you can argue, for example, that there are many regulations that are repeatedly done by this test. At some point, this might just average out and everybody might win at some point. You can also make a good argument that there are other policy instruments in place that address distributional or compensation type of problems. You have an income tax schedule that is maybe meant to protect poor people from really harmful things. I think there's a set of institutional arrangements that make this test sort of okay, or actually quite useful. I think with a global case, the fact that these are potential compensation is much more important. because there aren't that many regulations that are global and where you might think that at some point these winners and losers will average themselves out. There is no global income tax system or anything like that. So I think the there are actually serious questions how useful that criterion is for a regulation that affects everyone in the world. There is a stronger criterion in economics, which we call Pareto efficiency, or strict Pareto efficiency. And there we ask for a regulation whether it actually makes everyone better, or whether it actually makes no one better off and at least someone better off. No one worse off and someone better off. The implementation of that is really tricky, and I'm just going to mention a few things. They're in the theoretical literature on how to implement it on global public goods like climate change. There are some really thorny issues that I think have not been sorted out and have not made its way into the empirical estimates of these questions. There's a great literature by Chichilinsky and Heal, for example, where they look at that question how you can come up with purely Pareto improving policies that I think has just not resonated widely. So I think that's a tricky criterion. Okay, so those are sort of the efficiency type of approaches. There's another approach, and that is you can start with an explicit ethical framework, some welfare function, some idea of fairness or ethical principle, and then derive what the social cost of carbon in each region should be in that case. There's one strand that in the literature has been tested a lot. If you have a global planner who has a utilitarian outlook on the world, then that will lead to a social cost of carbon that is equity weighted, and you might have heard that term in the literature before. That's the one that has been tested in the literature. So there's an approach that a bunch of co-authors and I developed, and that Bill Nordhaus and Chris Hope and we with Fund have all implemented in the three integrated assessment models that have been used by the interagency group. So that's the one where you can find numbers for. But there are very, very strong assumptions behind this approach. So first of all, you need to assume that there is a global planner who actually wants to equalize per capita consumption levels across the world. That's a big one, right? You also have to assume that there are no transfer payments whatsoever between different countries. I like that literature. I've contributed a lot to it. But I think in terms of implementing that in a regulatory setting for the United States, I think that would be probably a leap of faith, quite frankly. There's also the question of why a utilitarian welfare function, right? Once you go down that route, my undergraduate degree is actually in philosophy, and we learned other ethical theories as well. So I think I think that is a really interesting debate in the literature, but I think right now the working group did well of staying clear of that in what they came up with. So my summary of the choices that the interagency group made on that question is, I think that essentially they made a sound choice in using a global number. I think that's largely a political decision. You will not be able to do a literature review and have that question decided for you. I think the use of this Calder-Hicks Pareto efficiency criterion, I mentioned a couple of problems with that, but those problems are, in my mind, largely a question of degree. They're present in a national context as well, and the criterion is used widely. So I think it was a safe and conservative approach to just stick with that. I think the use of equity weights would have opened the interagency work up to all sorts of criticisms that at this point they probably would not have wanted. Okay, so I'm clearly running out of time. So I will skip a couple of those and just mention a few of those. Okay, one thing I wanted to mention is, so these are things that I think are important going forward when we think about how we can come up with better and more sound numbers for the social cost of carbon. One problem in this field is that it's actually a really small field. So this is the cast of characters that work on the three models that the interagency group used. And it's good for me as a young academic that there are not many people there, but I think it's bad as a for a policy community that they're so that these groups are so small. And if you look at the share of funding and man hours spent in natural science models, for example, and compare it with this, there's just a huge imbalance. So I think that's one real issue here, that it's a small field and the core people that actually work on these integrated assessment models are not many. So I think that's a problem. And I hope with the more prominent role that the social cost of carbon is playing that might change at some point. Okay. Then I think the most interesting work in the future is going to improve these damage estimates that you heard about, these damage functions. I thought I'd just tell you how, for one example, how that works right now, how these damage functions are estimated. So someone comes up and publishes a climate scenario, and there's a point estimate of what that climate scenario will look like. Then some agricultural economist might come up and use that point estimate from a published paper and come up with an estimate of the impact on yields that might have. But he's not going back to the full, not necessarily going back to the full information that the climate modeler had. Often, especially with these integrated assessment models, you literally look at the published paper version and use the numbers that are in there. And then there's a whole chain of steps how that propagates from these impacts on yield estimates. Then someone uses a trade model to estimate the impacts on global consumer and producer surpluses. But again, at each of these steps, there's actually very little cooperation between these different groups. And I think that's a real issue, because a lot of information gets lost, and especially a lot of information about the uncertainties in these estimates gets lost in that pipeline as these different groups work together. And I think that will be a major challenge for us going forward, how we can get these different groups to actually work together and not just pick up the published journal articles that one group published and then some other group uses them, but actually in the design of the experiments that we're running and so on, work together and have a more fruitful exchange. So I think that is a big issue going forward. I'm going to skip over the next one. And I have 1 minute, right? OK, so I'm going to skip all of that. So in conclusion, I think, let me just see whether I have any other comments here. I think the interagency group, when they in their work, made a lot of good choices. I think there are a couple of minor things that I would have done differently, but I think the choices they made are not crazy. They're not outlandish, completely outside of the literature. It's also quite amazing. I mean, I've never been in government, but I imagine it's not exactly easy or fun to coordinate that many different agencies. So at some point you have to compromise, but I think broadly, all of the choices that the interagency group made are defensible, and you can trace them back in some way to the literature. And I've watched people use the social cost of carbon in Europe, and that has not always been the case. There have been, I've seen many cases where governmental agencies picked these numbers up and did things to them that are just completely wrong and crazy. That there's no other way to say that. And I think, none of that happened here, which is really great. I think we were asked to not talk about the discount rate, but I think it has to be mentioned nevertheless, because of all the choices you can make in this, probably one of the most important one is the choice of discount rate. The social cost of carbon that you get for different discount rates, the range is large. I think there is at this point enough and sufficient agreement in the literature that for very long time horizons, a declining discount rate is the appropriate approach. There was a very high level piece published in Science just this summer by Arrow and a whole bunch of other economists that argued for that. And I think at some point in the future, that would be a good choice for the United States government to approach a declining discount rate scheme for very long-term problems. So I think that is a major thing I think they should do. I think back then in 2007, maybe the case was slightly less strong and what they did was okay. And I think I'll stop at that point.
Great, thanks very much, David. And we now we'll hear from Rich Howard.
Yeah,
we don't have.
Yeah.
I assume that's your
Howarth. Yeah. Click on the. Okay, I'm going to take things in a slightly different direction and talk particularly about how to value uncertainty. This is ongoing work, based on ongoing work with my colleagues Mike Gerst and Mark Borsick in the engineering school at Dartmouth. Now, something that we haven't talked about this morning is that while there's not a statutory framework, except while the Clean Air Act in the United States for abating carbon, there is a treaty framework. And since 1992, the United States has been a signatory, a ratified signatory to the Framework Convention on Climate Change, which calls for stabilizing greenhouse gas concentrations in the atmosphere to prevent, quote unquote, dangerous anthropogenic interference with the atmosphere, with the climate. And that's something that was brought back to Washington by President Bush Sr. and ratified by the Senate. The treaty that arguably is binding on us, although there are lawyers in the room, so I should be careful about saying what's legally binding. We also have the Copenhagen Accord of 2009, which President Obama said yes to. And this basically operationalizes this dangerous anthropogenic interference criterion by saying that the world should strive to hold the long-run increase in mean global temperature relative to the pre-industrial norm to no more than about 2 degrees Celsius. That's a hard goal to meet. It would require a rapid transition away from fossil fuels. It could be done, though. The models that we've been talking about this morning indicate that could be done. So if I take the 2007 version of Nordhaus's DICE model, for example, and then you achieve this goal of maximizing social welfare subject to a 2 degrees Celsius temperature constraint, what that does is it means a phased transition away from fossil fuels. And that requires actually a carbon price that rises from about $19 in the present to somewhat over $210 a century down the road. And bear in mind that $19 per ton isn't that far off from about 19 cents per dollar of gasoline. So what this says is actually that fairly small price changes in this model could cause the kind of transition that would be needed to stay within this goal. Okay. And where does this come from? It doesn't come from maximizing social welfare or from a concern for economic efficiency, actually. You know, this says the goal is to prevent dangerous anthropogenic interference. And this is concerned deeply with the precautionary principle and with the idea that future generations have a right, a legal right, to protection from harm. Just as the Clean Air Act is premised, that the NAAQS standards under the Clean Air Act are premised on the prevention of harm, then this Framework Convention on Climate Change is concerned with that as well. Okay, now since the beginning, since the early 1990s, economists, notably Nordhaus, have argued against stringent short-run cuts in greenhouse gas emissions. And that's true because Nordhaus uses an economic efficiency argument. Basically, you can think of it as a version of the Calder-Hicks approach that David discussed. It's what economists call a revealed the preference approach. You know, and the idea is intuitively as follows. The expected damages of climate change, at least in the short run, aren't likely to be that high. Decision makers are impatient. And because they discount the future at a relatively high rate, they're just not willing to make the investments needed to stabilize climate, what I might call climate capital. This is a form of natural capital, actually. So the Dice model, in its base form, supports relatively low carbon prices. Now, what's missing from all of these models, I think, is a concern that Martin Weitzman raised in an important 2009 paper. That is that climate policy shouldn't be driven by cost-benefit analysis per se. It should be driven by this concern about risk prevention and precaution, right? Because there's a low probability of catastrophic outcomes if we don't act. And what I want to do in this talk is to walk you through kind of quickly some ideas from our work about how to operationalize Weitzman's conjecture in a version of the 2007 version of Nordhaus's model. And where that goes in terms of cost-benefit analysis and also in terms of where it goes in terms of the social cost of carbon. Okay, there's an equation on this slide, and I'll talk around it. What Nordhaus is doing is he's assuming that people's decisions about the rate of capital investment and also the rate of return that they demand on investment gives us a way of calibrating a social welfare function. And the decision makers in the global level are aiming to maximize social welfare. That's what happens in this model. Whether that's true or not, we can come back to in discussion. But the idea is to choose parameters for the pure rate of time preference and then this curvature parameter alpha that are supposed to be consistent with what we observe in terms of the rate of economic growth and in terms of people's impatience. And in particular, Nordhaus says that the parameters that he chooses for this are consistent with about a 2% rate of economic growth and about a 6% return on capital investment. And those values, I think, aren't empirically consistent. And they aren't empirically consistent for the following reason. When you look at it, the particular numbers that are used in these models for the curvature parameter alpha imply that safe and risky forms of investment should have returns that are about the same. And in reality, we know that's not the case. We know that treasury bills pay returns that are around zero, corrected for inflation, maybe 1%. Stock markets pay much higher than 6%. And what our group has done is basically opened the envelope and extended the envelope to look at what happens when we account for, what's driving the difference between the returns on safe and risky assets is risk. And when we value that risk, then we get a value for this coefficient alpha, which we think is between 5 and 6, actually. That's a number. What that means is that people are really risk averse. And we plug that high rate of risk aversion that we think is consistent with people's observed behavior, decision makers' observed behavior, into an uncertain probabilistic version of the Dice model. We don't run 100 runs or 10,000 runs. To make our analysis work, we actually need to do 100 million runs. And we need to do 100 million runs because we're looking for the welfare implications of things that happen on a 1 in a million basis, for example. If you're risk averse, you care about things that happen with very low probability. Okay. So we put together a stochastic version of Dice that in most of its assumptions is very much consistent with exactly the approach used by the interagency working group on purpose. And we force it with some scenarios, some emissions pathways that range from allowing emissions to rise in the short run to stringent, rapid emissions reductions. And the result we get is as follows. One is that there's a probability of a Weitzman-type economic collapse. This means that we say that that a consumption collapse occurs if sometime during the next 400 years consumption is driven all the way down to subsistence level. And that doesn't happen very much of the time. It happens. this is 1 in a million right here. So as we go to the right here, we're going to stricter and stricter emissions reductions on a shorter timeline is really what's going on here. And what we see here is that if we don't do any emissions abatement, we've got a risk that is, what, like 1 in 1,000. Is 1 in 1,000 a large risk on a 400-year time horizon? Well, it's a risk that we don't need to live with, because if we adopt something like the Copenhagen agreement, that target, we move ourselves out in this direction where we start to see risks that are more like 1 in 1 million, 1 in 100 million, right? That's why we do 100 million samples, is because we need these numbers. Now, what are the welfare implications? What we find is that what optimizes welfare is in the middle. You know, it's close to this pathway. So emissions decrease over time, but in a phased way, not too fast, not too slow. But what we also find is that really all of these lower pathways that involve transition away from greenhouse gas emissions lead to very, very large welfare gains. You know, I mean, hypothetically, it's more than 100% increase in economic welfare the way that we measure it in our paper. And what that means is that getting the risk out of this system generates very large benefits, given the way that we measure. It's really a certainty equivalent measure of welfare. And decision makers really want to get rid of the risk, and that means not being on these higher pathways and then favoring these lower pathways. We also find, in terms of the welfare analysis, that welfare is pretty much invariant with respect to how fast you get to stabilization, right? There's some difference here. It's the not huge differences. And then maybe finally, at least before turning to some discussion and giving a compressed talk, but maybe putting some ideas out there for people to think about, you know, the social cost of carbon is very, very sensitive to which policy scenario you're on. It's not a number. It depends on which policy decisions that you make, and it also depends on how you calibrate risk aversion in particular. You know, in our analysis, in our model, in our adopted version of Nordhaus's model, we find that in a no controls baseline, that the marginal present value benefit measured in certainty equivalence, taking risk aversion into account, the marginal cost of emissions today would be on the order of about $26,000 per ton of carbon if the world doesn't do anything about emissions. But as the stringency of emissions abatement increases, that falls first to around $1,000 a ton to around $100 per ton. In the welfare maximizing scenarios, we see a very low carbon price. In our analysis, it's around $4 a ton, which is even less than what you see in the IWG analysis. Why is that true? It's true for sort of complex reasons that have to do with the limitations of our model and this whole class of models, actually, the way we represent preferences. But you can think about this as in light of what's called the diamond water paradox. You know, we all need water, and yet the marginal value of water is low when water is provisioned adequately. And what I want to say is that I think that we need a carbon price, because price signals provide a gauge in which public policy choices, for example, can be made about where emissions reductions should occur. And then individual interests and collective interests can be aligned through individually rational decisions and through efficient, cost-effective policy solutions, for example. But to some extent, I think the right way, and I'm being normative here, I think the right way is something like what was envisioned in the Framework Convention on Climate Change, which is to choose a target, then find a cost-effective strategy for meeting that target, and then, to use economics language, use the shadow prices that come out of meeting the goal cost-effectively as a guideline for what to do at the micro level. And that gives us... if you believe the DICE model, see, one thing that's interesting, There's a lot of uncertainty about climate sensitivity and about the climate science. A lot of uncertainty about climate damages, which actually isn't adequately reflected in our analysis. Not so much uncertainty on the abatement cost side. And so I would say that what I think our work suggests is using numbers actually that aren't so far away from where the interagency working group wants to go or has been going, but basing it on a cost-effectiveness approach to meeting emissions abatement targets, I think maybe that's where we should go. Noting that, of course, we don't at this stage have the statutory framework to do it, and that it is, of course, challenging that at a regulatory level, we're trying to solve a problem that doesn't have a statute that really generates the regulatory framework. I mean, that's what I have to say, so thank you.
Thanks very much, Rich. So, so we started a little late, so we're going to eat up a little time. So we'll have about 10 minutes for questions and answers. So I want to first, I have about 50 questions that I could ask, but I'm going to turn it over to the audience and open it up for questions. So if you have a question, just raise your hand.
You mean like zero?
Well, at some level, the question embeds the answer, right? Because it would always be correct to price things appropriately. but I think what the question might be is, so then we have to ask, what is the appropriate way to price, right? And we've actually been given a couple of very different models up here, just over the course of our conversation, on what that appropriate level is. So is the appropriate level economic efficiency? Is that from a global perspective or from a domestic perspective? Is it more of a risk-based approach? So any other panels have thoughts on that?
Yeah, I mean, I've given my answer to that, although I think that what's appropriate actually boils down to some moral judgments about how we evaluate trade-offs between the interests of present and future generations. Something that we haven't discussed, but is behind my calculations and all of these models, is that climate stabilization, you know, would cost in the short run 1% of GDP plus or minus. I mean, we could argue about whether that's a little higher or a little lower. But in the long run, the impacts of not stabilizing climate are very, very much larger. So this is not a problem where it would be appropriate morally to apply the Calvert-Hicks criterion and say that we're only going to focus on the discounted net benefits, because the incidence of those impacts between the present and the future really matters. So there's a moral judgment, and we'll get the right price when the decision makers put the values on the table.
I'm not sure it answers your question, but I think one thing worth pointing out is that I think you would be hard-pressed right now to find an economist who would say there should be mm-hmm. no price on carbon, it's definitely zero. I think there's my reading of the economics profession right now that we debate about the level and so on, but I think broadly this really follows from very, very basic economic theory that you should do something about carbon emissions. This is not, and you will find that, I think, that opinion held by economists across the spectrum. I think that is maybe worth pointing out. I think there's a disconnect there between sometimes the public debate and what's the common idea within the economics profession.
Okay. We have Jonathan, and then Dale will come up next. Yep.
Hi, Jonathan Weaver from Duke University. That was very interesting. The question I want to ask is about the international strategy of the social cost of carbon, and related to some things that David Anthoff was mentioning about the limited impact of unilateral action, which might even be worse if you take into account leakage, although there might also be technological spillovers. But this is maybe I can give a shout out here to Dick Stewart, who's getting elbow surgery today. But he and I have written about this a lot over the last 20 years, not just the cost of carbon, but about how to design an international regime that motivates countries to want to participate. And so my question is, if collective action at the formal treaty is so difficult to be effective, to be ambitious, what do you think, what does the panel think of the prospects of a kind of tacit diffusion of parallel or reciprocity-based adoption of the social cost of carbon by the national governments of several major emitting countries? Even in the face of incentives to free ride and so forth, that expert elites within each country, like you, might say, hey, we should, this is a smart policy, we should adopt the social cost of carbon, and that collectively would accomplish some, or I wonder if you looked at how much, of the kinds of goals being sought through a formal international treaty. What do you think of those as two of several possible strategic options?
Yeah, I'd be happy to jump in there. You know, I was a little surprised by David's presentation in the sense that he emphasized that economics would find it very difficult to justify taking account of international damages. But if I understood your question correctly, there's an important dynamic element to this, which is that, and I think that one can see that, I think we ran the experiment roughly from 2000 to 2008 of, well, we're not going to do anything unless the Chinese do something. And I think we saw the results of that experiment. There is a clear dynamic element to this, and the United States is one of the richest countries, has an important role in, I think, helping set social norms and in making clear there'll be payoffs for other people for participating. And I think that can be, I think David wanted to emphasize the economics of it, but it's quite, and you can do that in the economic model, but it's quite clear there's a role for leadership and there's a role for hanging carrots out there. And I think that's how one can very easily get to a place where it's completely rational to have take account of international damages.
Yeah. I was more referring to the literature. There's a large literature that looks at the prospect of international agreements on climate change, and from that literature, you would not expect something like the United States adopting a global social cost of carbon, but they did. Right? So.
But I think the point I want to emphasize is I think we're holding out the literature in a particularly a piece of it in a very hallowed way. But the simplest tweaks to any economic model of international negotiations would encompass the dynamic element of it. And that would naturally lead to accounting for international value. So I think it's a mischaracterization of the literature to say that that would provide support for domestic only damages.
Yeah. So I think actually this is an area that, again, is really not an economics question, what the reaction will be, because I think that's largely a public policy question. I just, out of my personal experience, since the social cost of carbon has been implemented in the United States, lots of people from other countries have approached us and asked about, do you have a social cost of carbon for that we could use in our domestic setting? So I think that is actually... I agree with your point that there might be dynamics that other countries pick this up. I think.
All right. So Dan, we'll ask Gugdale and then Dan, just to add a final thought on Jonathan's point. If that dynamic of diffusion does exist, the question would be what is the social cost of carbon that we would want to diffuse, and the answer to that would be a global social cost of carbon.
Yeah. Yeah, this is a factual question for, I think, Michael. So I wasn't really sure in the end how our social cost of carbon actually weighs global damages relative to domestic damages. Is there a simple answer to that question?
It includes all damages around the world.
And treats them as being of equal value?
Yes. Yeah. But I am very happy to be asked any question about fashion.
Dan.
Yes. So Tom Schelling's old argument was that if we believe that reducing emissions today will, in the United States, for example, will largely benefit someone in sub-Saharan Africa in 20 years who might be poorer than we are today here in the United States, that that might give reason to use a negative discount rate to value the damages that occurred to that person in sub-Saharan Africa. That is actually entirely equivalent to a social cost of carbon that uses equity weights. And it follows from this utilitarian idea that a dollar damage to a poor person causes more welfare loss than a dollar damage to someone rich, because I gain much more from an extra dollar than Bill Gates, and that sort of argument scales.
Actually, Bill Gates gives his money to kids with malaria, right? So actually, the social welfare would be a transfer to Bill Gates.
So if you start with that, you're taking into account distributional questions, and you take into account, there's a large literature on that. I've actually written a fair amount on that. But it does make very, very strong assumptions about how you value different people in different places, and you're outside of this world of pure efficiency that cost-benefit analysis traditionally is in, right? So that's...
Yeah,
Richard. It seems like you sort of gloss over the idea of, and say, well, it's the right thing to do to include social benefits to the entire world. But once you open that door, any policy then, you could say, if we've opened this door, any policy that harms the United States at the expense of another country, then you just looking at the net benefits to the entire world. I mean, the thing is that it may make sense in this context, but if you adopt that as policy for all U.S. policy, it seems like you're just opening a huge can of worms. And unless you find a way to limit it, I think there's a problem there.
If I can weigh in on this. So I think we're all heading on the same point, that at some level, the decision of whether or not to include global damages is not an economic question, it's a political economy question. And in the case, David was saying, the concern that if, say the U.S. were to reduce its emissions, then other countries might raise their emissions to compensate. That's looking at it in this very narrow sort of local context. Everybody benefits greatly if you go from the particular Nash equilibrium we're in to a higher mitigation world. And so it's the entire framework of sort of the political economy of getting from there to here to there. But the argument about reciprocity doesn't work at all if you're say, Kiriba, right? Whatever you do is not going to have much of an impact in terms of world leadership. If you're in the United States,
Let me just give you an example. Right. We have a number of policies we've tried to bring production back to the U.S. Away from other countries. Well, that's harming other countries. Should we not value the harm to other countries?
Right, I think even more straightforwardly, right? If you use a straight utility maximization global framework, then just exporting money would be utility maximizing at rates that are much higher than we currently do now. The question is the climate context different? And I think there are answers to that.
I think we're missing a point here. The reason we have international trade organizations is very similar to this. It's that everyone benefits if tariffs are lower. And I think there is a good analogy to that here. So the exporting money, I think that's a separate issue. Your example was the businesses competing with each other or countries competing with each other. I think the point is this is something that will require action by all countries. And it's not just one country undertaking a policy that harms others. So I think we're missing the point here. And I don't want to keep harping back claiming this as an economic issue, but it really kind of is. It's really only the crudest economic models that would not take account of the dynamics of this. And you can embed this in a, to use the language we were using earlier, welfare maximizing viewpoint of that would lead to using international values.
Yeah. Peter.
One of the things I was wondering is, I've been doing a lot of work on the damages, and I'm concerned when I look at them that there are a lot of things that are being missing from the damages. And particularly one thing that David Anton brought up was the idea that inter-regional damages are included. And I don't see how that those are subsumed into the current estimates. And particularly one area I would raise is, fund is currently the only model that includes migration, but none of the other models do. And so it seems hard to believe that those interregional damages are being included. So I want to just want to clarify why you think that. And then two, what do people think about how much larger these damages could possibly get when we start including things like socially contingent damages and other
So I guess I should go again. So one thing that needs to be stressed is that a lot of things that might happen are not included in these models, right? So so essentially something gets included in our model once someone has published a global estimate for a particular phenomenon that we can then take and put into our model. There are lots of things where we have, for example, excellent studies for one country, but there's just no literature out there that tells us something that effect on a broader scale. And I think, by and large, every of the three models has then taken the approach that either we have something that's consistent or we leave it out, right? So that is really important. There are lots of areas that are just not accounted for, right, where there might be benefits. I think there are different schools of thought what the proper way to deal with that is. One is you can say, let's just add, I don't know, some number to the damages in the model to make up for missing estimates. And that is, for example, something that Bill Nordhaus is doing now for his latest version of the DICE model. He just took a number that is sort of based on the literature, and then he said, I'll add 25% because I think things are missing. Or do you leave, do you stick to what you can find in the literature and then explicitly say that's all that's in there, and if a policymaker takes that and thinks there are other things that are important that are not accounted for, then I'll leave that sort of to the policy process to address that somehow. I should also say on the spillovers, there are some sectors where spillovers are accounted for. I think especially in agriculture that is true. That if you go back to the studies that we rely on, that's really one of the core things they do there. There are other areas where I should have been more careful, where spillovers certainly are missing. But there are a whole lot of things are missing.
Any other final thoughts from any of our panelists?
I think it's the unknown unknowns that actually should drive policy. And that's a problem because both on the natural science side and on the economic side, there are structural relationships that we don't understand well enough to get the damages right, as it were. And so that means that we need to make decisions under very strong uncertainty. And making rational decisions under really strong uncertainty is in risk assessment and also in economics. It gets into things that that the current literature is not handling well, which is not a criticism of the current literature. These are very, very hard problems. This is then why the framework convention goes back to the DAI criteria.
Can I just ask one?
Sure, absolutely.
This social, it's a wonderful working group. Have you been able to export it? Does the social conclusions, have they been exported to the EU sector? Because we're in the middle of the EU trade. Have you sold the program?
I have not followed it terribly closely. My understanding is it's been used in court cases all over the place. The EU has their own emissions trading system that was already set up. I think it's probably become something of a focal point as countries think about carbon taxes and where to set their caps on cap and trades to produce prices. But, these things aren't, there's not a bright red line that connects all the dots. But my understanding is it's been influential.
A final question from Don Elliott.
Just in defense of Mike Livermore's idea about giving people money, I think that Schelling's argument is a little bit more provocative than what's been described, in the sense that, as I understand it, if you are engaged in a wealth transfer of people in the future through reducing climate change, you're engaged in a wealth transfer that's in kind. That is, you're giving them a particular thing, a better environment. And Schelling's argument, as I understand it, as a foreign affairs piece, is you would benefit people in sub-Saharan Africa more by giving them money now so that they're in a better position to adapt, as opposed to making that choice for them as to how that money will be used by mitigating climate change. So I think it's a more provocative argument that because you're not, you don't have just a single good, that is the environment or climate change. It's a question of how does this form of investment compare from an opportunity cost standpoint to other ways you might invest the same amount of resources.
That's true, except that he's also pointing out that the beneficiaries of abatement will be future generations, not people here and now. And then he's arguing, partly rightly, maybe partly wrongly, that necessarily that the people in the future who will receive the benefits of climate stability will have relatively high incomes. And I think Schelling's argument, there's a weakness there that what happens if much of Africa is stuck in a poverty trap and their incomes don't increase the way that we hope that they do? You're exactly right. It's a very provocative and very interesting argument that I think all of us should look at harder.
Well, with that thought, I would like to thank our panelists for a very provocative discussion. I have been charged with making the following announcement. So due to an important and unavoidable schedule change, Howard Solansky isn't going to be with us for lunch. We are going to be changing around the schedule, and our hope is that he'll be able to join us later in the day. So we're going to break for lunch now, reconvene at 12:30 for our panel on jobs and regulation, which we can do over lunch. We'll then hear from our panel on celebrating the executive order 12866 at 2 o'clock. That'll go to 3:30. And then our hope is that Howard's helicopter will land promptly at JFK and we'll be able to see him at 3:30. Thanks very much.